Good morning.
Good morning.
What a beautiful Easter Sunday. Welcome to the Abraham Lincoln Unitarian Universalist Congregation, a religious community of more than 250 members and friends. Whether you are joining us today in person or virtually or by live stream or on YouTube, we are glad you are with us. My name is Allison Stakera, and I am your service leader today. Today is the last day of March, and with that comes the observance of the International Transgender Day of Visibility. All right, and April Fool's Day is tomorrow. There is no relationship between those two things. On a more serious note, the 3rd of April marks 55 years since Martin Luther King Jr. gave his mountaintop speech. The following day, April 4th, 1968, Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. On a lighter note, did you know that Star Trek Day is April 5th? I didn't write this. But there is a question. Are there any Trekkies among us? Well, look at all of you. I love that. Okay. Let's see, announcements. That's now I had to giggle out loud when I read this one. Okay, not that this isn't funny, it's not, but the end is. Hold on. We have, this is tight, so thought was put into this. We have six final breads for sale, the extra left at the end of our successful spring bread bake sale. There are two banana breads and four carrot cake loaves. They are $16 each while supplies last. Now the part that made me giggle. You can purchase them after the service by seeing Marissa in the corner. That's where Marissa is. She's in the corner. All right, let's see. We also have... okay, and a correction on your order of service. The flowers today, which are amazing... gorgeous, were arranged by Kathy Brookshire, Tabitha Bernhardt, Talia Panici, and Vi Lanham. Oh, I'm sorry. Paniki. Sorry. I should know better. And then Diana. Oh, there you are. An announcement for the fantasy auction.
Good morning, everyone. Okay, so I'm here to ask people to make desserts or appetizers for this fantasy auction. Last week, I think I got at least 10 people signed up, but frankly, I need at least 10 more because they come hungry, okay? All right, the other thing I want to mention, we're going to do a soft opening for EcoCamp this week for registration. So if you know someone who is will be 6 years old or entering first grade come next fall, all the way up to age 12, those are our campers, and from 13 up, thank you, Marissa, 13 up, those are our teen counselors. And during Eco Camp, which will be the last week of full week in July, our campers learn to be good stewards of the earth. And we have fun Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, which is water day, which is just amazing. But I just wanted to give you a heads up that registration will have a soft opening this week. And again, I need food. See me, sign up. Thank you.
Thank you. As a reminder, as you leave today, please return your songbook, the order of service, and the announcement sheets to the table by the sanctuary door. Ushers will do the reshelving and recycling for you. Now, there are no more additional announcements, so it is time for our Change for Change. Today is the last day for Change for Change donations for the month of March. No baskets will be coming around today, no baskets. But just a reminder that the Coalition of Rainbow Alliances, known as CORAL, was the March recipient. So if you would like to donate, please make your checks out to ALUUC and mark C4C in the or CORAL in the memo line. And you can put those in the regular offertory plate as that comes around. Or you may go to the website, aluuc.org, to donate there. Now, let's all stand and greet those neighbors nearby. Holy moly, such enthusiasm. Now comes our call to worship. We have come together today as a community of faith, so let us please begin our service. We, as Unitarian Universalists, honor your mind, your heart, and your journey. We are a people of many paths who are brave, curious, and compassionate thinkers and doers, diverse in age, abilities, ethnicity, gender, economic status, political persuasions, and spirituality. We come together to create a force for good more powerful than any of us could be alone. We are formally recognized by the National Unitarian Universalist Association as a welcoming congregation, which signifies that we celebrate and honor the lives, relationships, and full participation of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender persons and those individuals who self-identify their gender. We have different beliefs, but we share a constellation of values which may be referenced on the back of your order of service. What binds us together is a covenant with other Unitarian Universalist congregations. We have many brochures in the foyer giving lots of information on Unitarian Universalism, and you are welcome to take them home with you. Our board members wear green name badges, and those individuals are all part of our self-governing congregation, a pillar of Unitarian Universalism. Should you have questions about Unitarian Universalism, or if you are interested in becoming a member of this congregation, you may speak with our minister, Reverend Martin Woulfe, or our membership coordinator, Heather Vining, after the service. Both of them will be available. And now, our prelude with the choir singing, O Young and Fearless Prophet.
Thank you.
Would my daughter please join me in the chalice lighting this morning? This flame affirms the light of truth, the warmth of community, and the fire of commitment. Please repeat after us.
May the light we now kindle
inspire us to use our powers
to heal and not to harm,
to help and not to hinder,
to bless and not to curse,
to serve you, Spirit of Freedom.
Before I commence with the opening words today, I'd like to acknowledge that a horrid attack occurred in Rockford, Illinois on Wednesday, leaving 4 killed, 7 desperately injured, using other forms other than a gun. A reminder that violence continues to plague our society and to injure us personally and our humanity. And so our thoughts and prayers are with those victims and their families. And the victims, the 4 people who died, have been identified as Jenna Newcomb, age 15, Jacob Schupach, age 23, Jay Larson, age 49, and Romana Schupach, age 63. I invite us to share a few moments of respectful silence. Amen. I have noticed of late wild flowers, wild winds, butterflies and bees. It is a time of transformation, of renewal and rebirth, perhaps even a renaissance. Once again, the seasons have turned and we rejoice in the warmth of the sun, the return of the light, and all of our newfound friends of flowers in the fields. We share an optimism that life will continue and that the blessings of life will shower upon us just as surely as the showers of April will descend. On this day, when our neighbors celebrate resurrection, let us commend them and join in our celebration of renewal and rebirth, so that all people may rejoice in the spirit of spring. I invite you to please rise in body or in spirit. Let us join our voices in number 369. This is the truth that passes understanding.
Thank you.
We have a poem today to honor Women's History Month. And it is a different poem than the one listed in your order of service slightly. I encourage you to go home and read the one in your order of service. But you get a bonus poem today. It's the same author, Ada Limone, who is the author of 6 books of poetry, including The Carrying, which won the National Book Critics Circle Award for poetry. Her most recent book of poetry, The Hurting Kind, was shortlisted for the Griffin Poetry Prize. She is the 24th Poet Laureate of the United States and the recipient of a MacArthur Fellowship. As the Poet Laureate, her signature project is called You Are Here, and it focuses on how poetry can help connect us to the natural world. In the poem that I'm about to read, Ada Limone says about it, "It was a hard winter, and my whole body raged against it. But right as the world feels uninhabitable, something miraculous happens. The trees come back. I wanted to praise that ordinary thing as a way of bringing myself back, too." And here is her poem. Instructions on Not Giving Up. More than the fuchsia funnels breaking out of the crabapple tree, more than the neighbor's almost obscene display of cherry limbs shoving their cotton candy-colored blossoms to the slate sky of spring rains, it's the greening of the leaves that really gets to me. When all the shock of white and taffy, the world's baubles and trinkets, leave the pavement strewn with the confetti of aftermath, the leaves come. Patient, plodding, a green skin growing over whatever winter did to us. A return to the strange idea of continuous living despite the mess of us, the hurt, the empty. Fine then, I'll take it, the tree seems to say. A new slick leaf unfurling like a fist to an open palm. I'll take it all. All right. Now it is time for our offering. We come together today to support this community of seekers to which we all belong. With this support, we continue the legacy of a faith community here on the prairie. Will the ushers please come forward to receive our offering?
Thank you.
Now, if you would please join us in singing our gratitude song two times through.
If you'll please look on the back of your order service, you'll see the words to our sung milestones. First, we will sing the words and then hum them to the tune. And during the time of humming, if you would please call out a name that you think needs recognition or you'd like to just recognize in happiness or sorrow. And then we'll sing again.
Love, prepare me to be a sanctuary.
We have just sung, "Let Love Prepare Me as a Sanctuary." These are lovely, stirring words that go deep into the spirit and deep into the heart. During our time of silent reflection, I invite us to remember those who have loved us and those whom we have loved or do love, and how that has transformed us, and reflect on the larger transformation of love at work in this world. I have several favorite passages from the Christian scriptures. Notice I refer to them as the Christian scriptures and not the New Testament. That is deliberate, and it is spoken because the word New Testament has an unwritten bias. But in the scriptures, in particular in the Christian scriptures, one of my favorite passages is when Jesus turns to his followers and says, "Who do you say that I am?" And this particular question echoes a question when Moses encountered a burning bush, and he asked, "Who are you?" And he hears a voice that says, "I am who I am," which is translated in Hebrew as Yahweh. But if you say Yahweh without the vowels, as is customary in Jewish, it comes across as Yahweh, which is almost the sound of a breath. And so the breath of life is the name of God, according to the early writers. And when Jesus says, "Do you know, or who do you say that I am?" He doesn't say, "I am this, I am that," but he's curious. Who am I? What are the people saying? What do you yourself say? And that particular question has continued to echo down the centuries and millennia, and has been one of the tantalizing questions at the root of the Christian scriptures and the understanding of who was this individual called Jesus, Yahshua, Christos, Messiah. Many have advanced their theories. They have answered the question that this individual 2,000 years ago declined to answer for himself. Some have said, "You are the Son of God." Strange, because he only referred to himself as the Son of Man. Some have said, "You are Jesus Christ's superstar." Fascinating. Several months ago, I did watch that 50th anniversary tour of Jesus Christ Superstar. And as I did when I was a teenager, I wept at certain points. It is a passionate, powerful story. A story that has been committed to the film, as well as countless stories. "The greatest story ever told," said some. And so many of our neighbors continue to tell that story and to tease out the answer to that question. Who was this individual, Yahshua, Jesus, who lived and died? And they also ask, who was responsible for his death? But most important for our neighbors, and then what happened after his death? A branch of theological reflection called eschatology, a study of the end times. Without eschatology, Jesus would be forgotten amongst most of our neighbors. When I was a brand new UU, I met with some of my friends who were still devout Catholics at the time, and they were scandalized by my views of who Jesus may have been. I believed he was a human being, perhaps a prophetic voice, a religious genius. And they were scandalized. And they said, "But it clearly is written that he was the Son of God. And so if you are going to accept your position, you have to accept one of two possibilities, that Jesus was a liar or that he was insane. So which is it?" And they insisted I demand that I respond to that question. In the decades since then, I've learned that the answer is not black and white, it's not so cut and dry, that there are many, many variations of response dependent upon which sources you have read, and whether it's strictly the canonical versions, but also which version of the so-called Bible or book you have read. Protestants and Catholics have a decidedly different interpretation and depiction of who Jesus was. If you've ever walked into a Catholic church, you will see a crucifix and the suffering Christ upon a cross. A very different understanding than what most Protestants depict of the risen Christ and an empty cross. So depending upon how you were raised and which version of the Bible, King James or the official Catholic or the one of the other countless versions, you will come to a different understanding, as different as Andrew Lloyd Webber from the author of The Last Temptation of Christ. Which is it? John Calvin had an answer. Thomas Aquinas had an answer. James, the brother of Jesus, had an answer. Paul had his own answer, St. Paul, which has endured across the scope of the centuries and launched onto the world. And it is correct to say that the version of Christianity, which is widely accepted and practiced amongst our brothers and sisters, is Pauline Christianity, very distinct from the Christianity, the Christian movement launched by Jesus and his earliest followers. Our Unitarian and liberal ancestors proposed 400 years ago that when they read the Bible, it depicted an individual who had a transformational moment. And yes, even 400 years ago, just like today, there was a variance of opinion. Did it occur prior to his birth? Did it occur at his birth? Did it occur at his baptism? When did the Spirit of God stir within him? And what exactly did that mean? Did it mean that he was unique among all humankind? Did it mean that he had a dual nature, part divine, part human? Or did it mean that he was fully divine and fully human at the same time? Fascinating, intriguing questions that have launched the publication of an extraordinary number of scrolls and books and continues to do so to this day. Unitarian Universalists, 200 years ago, launched our movement with a sermon entitled Unitarian Christianity, sometimes called the Baltimore Sermon, by William Ellery Channing. And he said, this is one of the most distinctive and exciting questions of ourselves and our brothers and sisters. Who was Jesus and what was his mission on earth? And from whence did it derive? Channing and his contemporaries understood that even amongst themselves, there was a great diversity. Some of them followed the Socinian method, and when they read the scriptures, they understood that the Gospel of Mark was the first original testament and therefore had the most credibility. And if you read the Gospel of Mark by itself, you discover that Jesus is strictly a faith healer with no extraordinary claims about himself. There is no resurrection story that is in the Gospel of Mark, except one that was added by medieval monks many centuries later. And so when early liberals read Mark, they understood that Jesus was a profound and deeply spiritual individual who was on earth to continue the work of John the Baptist. John the Baptist having been brutally murdered, the question then came to Jesus, either the other followers of John or Jesus himself, asking, if John is dead, and if John's mission was to lead people back to a redemptive spirit and reconciliation with God, and John is now dead, who must lead this movement? And no doubt individuals turned to Yashu, Jesus, and Jesus must have asked himself, what does this mean? If our leader, my leader, John, sacred in his mission, has been brutally murdered by civilian authorities, what then must my role be? And as you decipher and read through the scriptures, you see this individual, Yashu, coming to a realization that perhaps he is called by God, by the Holy Spirit, by the divine, to lead this movement even further than John could have. It's a powerful story. In the century since, we have seen many individuals emphasize certain scriptures, discount others, and most of our neighbors will exalt the Gospel of John, in which Jesus is now the Logos that pre-exists at the beginning of time with God and is synonymous with God the Father, and pay little attention to the Gospel of Mark, just as they will dismiss the Gospel of James, who is Jesus' brother, and focus on John and also the Testament, the letters of Paul, formerly Saul, the man who was moved by his conversion experience and extended to the world his vision of Jesus, where his childhood and his teachings were of no importance, The only importance was that he was the Son of God, crucified by human beings, and his death led to the resurrection, which led to the forgiveness of sins of his true believers. That, again, is Paul, not Jesus, not James, not the apostles, St. Paul, Pauline Christianity. Now, in more recent times, we've had a plethora, and I love saying that word, plethora of authors tease out, what does it mean? Who was this Jesus? Albert Schweitzer, the Reverend Dr. Albert Schweitzer, who was a genius of his own standing, both a doctor of theology, a doctor of medicine, a doctor of music, was dismissed and tried as a heretic within his Lutheran fold because his views of Jesus were unorthodox. And later in life, he was accepted into the Church of the Wider Fellowship, a UU organization. But as a younger theologian in seminary, he wrote a seminal work called The Quest for the Historical Jesus. And in that book, he recounts how, in the time of the Enlightenment, the understanding of who Jesus was transforms depending upon who is writing the story. And he also points out it depends on whether the author likes Jesus or hates Jesus, and that very different interpretations by his contemporaries were put forward, some of which would be shocking to our ears. But Schweitzer said, your understanding of who Jesus was really reflects your own nature more than the historical Jesus, because much of what we know was lost in that first century. We do know that when Jesus spoke to his disciples, he wrote nothing except once drawing in the dirt. He himself recorded nothing about himself, of who he was or what his mission was. The apostles, the 12 and then the 11, did not write their own stories. The people who wrote the four Gospels were not amongst the earliest followers of Jesus. And the earliest one was written between 40 and 60 years after the crucifixion. That was Mark. And then Matthew and Luke were written about 80 years following the crucifixion. And then 100 years after the crucifixion was the Gospel of John. And so the further away from written testimony, the more exalted this being becomes. Interesting. John Shelby Spong, who spoke here, has written a number of books, including This Jewish Lord, Looking Through Jesus Through Jewish Eyes. And it's become very much part of our milieu that we revisit and try and re-understand the world in which Jesus and his followers lived and breathed, and to understand that much of what he did, as recorded in the scriptures, followed that of a typical Jewish devout individual. His contemporaries, as recorded in those scriptures, referred to him as rabbi, and they explained to a non-Jewish audience, rabbi is the word we use for teacher. Sometimes they call him master, synonymous with rabbi. Some, after the crucifixion, begin to call him a prophetic individual, and much, much later, the Son of God. Again, very different and dissonant with the description often used, Son of Man, which means born of a woman. Rebecca Parker, who is a Unitarian Universalist, former dean of the Starr King School of Theology, co-wrote a book called Saving Paradise. And her research, based on the altars that have been discovered within the earliest Christian churches, show that the emphasis was never on death, doom, judgment, but on how the spirit of the living spirit, the divine spark, existed, and the kingdom of God was something to enjoy in the here and now, not in some far-off, distant netherworld. Bart Ehrman, who is famous as a critic of many authors, Orthodox authors, is also famous as an atheist. But he wrote a book saying, did Jesus exist? And it's his contention that based on the ancient authors, it is clear that an individual named Jesus must have existed. It doesn't mean that the later claims of his adherents hold water, but there certainly was an individual who moved the spirits of his immediate generation, his followers, people who were moved to love and who mourned very deeply after his untimely death. In Unitarian Universalist communities, up until about 100 years ago, most of our congregations were named the Church of the Messiah. But when religious liberals refer to the Messiah, they understand that this was a term that the Jewish people had used of a person especially anointed in the service of a sacred mission. And so it was that messiahs, or those who were anointed, including all the priests of the temple, all the royalty of Judea, as well as those who had a sacred calling, individuals such as Yahshua or Jesus. And they honored that calling, and they understood that Jesus was the most perfect human being, an exemplar of meekness, gentleness, an individual who, although innocent, was brutally murdered by the occupation forces of that territory. It is common to hear some of our contemporaries speak of that Jesus was the great liberator. And so another transformation when we ask the question, who was Jesus? They will say that he came to liberate all, and that if we are going to follow Jesus, we must be engaged in the work of liberation. Whereas our ancestors might have spoken of the liberation from death and doom and eternal hellfire, the work of liberation for our blessed contemporaries means the breaking of chains of systemic racism and hatred that bind individuals. And isn't it extraordinary that, at least on this particular Easter, that this sacred day coincides with the day, International Day of Transgender Recognition? Who needs liberation today? Who is oppressed? Who is weighed down? We can talk about those who are in the rising generations who are burdened with debt, who cannot afford a home, who cannot afford a college education. We can talk about those individuals who are systemically excluded from the right to vote. There is much oppression that continues in our day. And so when we ask ourselves, what does it mean to follow in the footsteps of the nominal founder of Christianity? What is the task that remains for us? What spiritual crosses are individuals called to hold and to carry in our lifetimes? Easter lends itself to many interpretations. Our blessed neighbors will speak about a resurrection. Literally, something that was dead was called back to life. There are only several other instances recorded in Scripture. A little girl, Talia, Talia, come back to life, said Jesus, and his beloved friend Lazarus, and then Yahshua or Jesus himself. It's an extraordinary, miraculous event which has not been repeated in real life for thousands of years. And it's questionable what happened then. It's questionable what happened when the stone was rolled away from the tomb. But to our neighbors who are enthralled with the study of eschatology, the theory of end times and the end of Jesus, that is compelling. But again, how many of you were raised in a traditional Orthodox Christian household? Raise your hands, please. How many of you could still recite, if I ask you, the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, which was devised at the Council of Nicaea in a spirited contest between the forces of Bishop Arius and Athanasius in a series of councils that at one point declared that Jesus was not the Son of God, that Jesus was a unique creation, and the followers of Athanasius who said, no, God had a triune nature and Jesus was coexistent with God. And so eventually when the Emperor Constantine intervened, because this was disrupting his governance of the empire, it was decided that the Nicene Creed, as written by Athanasius and assisted by Saint Nicholas of Santa Claus fame. And so Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered and died under Pontius Pilate and was resurrected on the third day after ascending to hell. To be an Orthodox Christian, that is paramount. That Jesus had a miraculous, extraordinary birth and a miraculous, extraordinary death and resurrection. What about his life? What about his teachings, his parables? If you are an Orthodox Christian, certainly a follower of someone like St. Paul, John Calvin, Aquinas, that is irrelevant. What is relevant about who this individual was is that he was born of a miracle and died in a miracle. But for religious liberals, what is important is that asterisk between his miraculous birth and miraculous death, the teachings, the scriptures that tell us about, the parables. And you have to understand that Jesus of Galilee was not an educated person. He was not a person who had gone to Oxford. In the idiom of his generation, he spoke with what would be the equivalent of someone coming to our midst and speaking with a deep southern drawl and saying, "Follow me." And the educated individuals of his day sneered at him because he was so uneducated and he had such an improper accent. And yet when we read his words printed in Elizabethan English, we get a very different individual indeed. And it's that individual, that understanding, which continues to march forward. And we can march alongside our more Orthodox brothers and sisters. We do have an unorthodox understanding of who this individual was. And even amongst this assembly, amongst Unitarian Universalists and the liberal Christians, there is no one dominant understanding or interpretation of who this individual was. But we understand that he was called. We understand that we ourselves are called, that the divine spark is in each and every person, that how we respond to that divine calling determines our presence in the quote-unquote kingdom of the Holy One. And so the work continues, the call continues, and I hope that we will continue to join with people of good faith, regardless of how they characterize their denomination, because there is much common ground. The call is universal. And as we do this, we further the blessings of creation. Amen and blessed be. In celebration of the advent of spring and the theme of rebirth, renewal, and perhaps even resurrection, let us join our voices, please stand as you're able, and lo, the earth awakes again.
Oh,
For our closing words, I offer you a benediction by my colleague, the Reverend Mark Bellatini, who, like myself, was raised in the Christian tradition. Let us go in peace. Let us live simply and gently at home within ourselves. Let us learn to act justly and to speak justly. Let us remember the depth of our own compassion. Let us not forget our power in the days of being powerless. Let us not desire to be wealthier than our peers, and let us not stint our hand of charity. Let us always practice forbearance. Let us speak the truth or speak not. Let us take care of ourselves as bodies, for this is a good gift. Let us crave peace for all people throughout this entire world, beginning with ourselves and extending to those who are different from us, those who are in harm's way. And let us go as we go with the dream of that peace stirring alive in all of our hearts. Amen and blessed be.
I brought another member of my family this time.
Hi.
This is Eric. We extinguish this flame.
But not the light of truth.
The warmth of community.
Or the fire of commitment.
These are in our hearts always.
So I'm fortunate that the church allows me to play songs that I choose that come from my Christian background, which has a very, for me, Easter was a very lovely memory with my family. So all the songs that I play, like the old record crosses, which is what I'm going to play, it has really good meaning for me. And for those for whom it's not a good feeling, I'm sorry for bringing something up that you don't want to think about. But I do want to celebrate that. Plus, the old rugged cross was a very special song for my brother-in-law, who passed away several years ago. It was the song his mother used to sing to him when he was a baby. It was the one thing he remembered about her. So I'll be doing a couple of Easter songs and rejoicing and knowing that Jesus' teachings are what keep me believing, because his words are being so misconstrued in much of the media today. But his teachings would be the really the answer if we could all live by them, including love one another, right?